Good morning. Happy Father's Day. We're so glad that you chose to worship with us this morning. We do have a couple of announcements to share with you. The flower arrangement to my left and to your right is given to the glory of God by Jim Kell in honor of Christine's birthday. Thank you, Jim and Christine, for sharing the flowers. Just a reminder that the 2020 church directory is available if you want to come by Monday through Thursday, 9 o'clock to 12 o'clock. There's someone here in the office at that time. We'd be glad to give you your directory. And also the directory of activities booklet that has been put together that describes all of our committees and who the chairperson and contact numbers are. That also is available if you'd like a copy. We are approaching the end of the month. The July-August Upper Room devotional is now available. If you'd like to pick one of those up, we will also have those available here in the office. At the end of the service, we will post contact information. So if you are viewing us for the first time and you'd like to connect with us in any way, there will be a way for you to do so at the end of the service. Please join me now in our call to worship. Like the strong but gentle father who supports a child's first steps,
God guides us along the path of life.
Like the loving grandfather who gathers us into an abundant lap,
God holds us in our time of need.
Like a lasting friend who seems to sense our needs,
God is mysteriously working for good in all things.
In many ways and with many faces,
God is loving us. Amen.
Well, let us now sing our opening hymn, This Is My Father's World, chosen for Father's Day. Bow our heads and pray. Creator God and our Heavenly Father, we humbly bow before your presence as we are aware of all the beauty, mystery, and wonder of your creation. God, we thank you for giving us the great gift of life. We also thank you today for fathers and men who follow you and who give their gifts of love, service, and witness to the families, church, and community. We pray that more men will answer our Lord's call to seek and to serve you. In Christ's holy name we pray. Amen. The first lesson this morning is from the Gospel of Matthew. I am reading chapter 7, verses 9 through 11. Hear the word of the Lord. Which of you, if his son asks for bread, will give him a stone? Or if he asks for a fish, will give him a snake? If you then, though are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask him? So in everything, do to others what you would have them do to you, for this sums up the law and the prophets. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And now I'd like to invite the children to come forward for our children's message. So glad that you're here. Today we are celebrating Father's Day, and you still have your dad. He's right over there. And I hope that on Father's Day you will make sure that he knows how much you love and appreciate him. My dad passed away a number of years ago. He died in 2010, but I have such good memories of him because my dad gave me some really important things. Actually, they're not things themselves, but gifts, if you will. The first one that he gave me was the gift of his time. When I was 8 years old, I tried out for Little League Baseball, and I got hit in the head with a ball, and that hurt. And as an 8-year old, I was kind of a wimp. I said, I don't want to play anymore. I got hurt. But my dad, in his wisdom, knew that I needed to be involved somewhere. And so dad got me involved in the scouting program. And so I brought my scout uniform that I wore. And it still got some of the badges on it. And that reminds me that my father knew me well. I wasn't going to be a great athlete. I was average but mediocre. I was never going to be a star athlete. But I loved the outdoors, and the scouting program was perfect. But the gift he gave me was the gift of time. My dad quit his pinochle league playing cards so that he could be a scout leader and spend time with his son in the scouting program. So my scouting uniform reminds me that my dad gave me the gift of his time. The second thing he gave me was the gift of his love. And I brought my driver's license and car keys to tell another story. I was in my last year of high school. Dad taught me how to drive. And I got my driver's license. Oh, let me tell you, As an 18-year-old, I was a late bloomer. I was so happy to get my driver's license. Dad let me borrow the car one night, but it was raining. And Dad said to me, "Bob, I want you to be careful on the road because they're going to be extra slippery." Well, I was taking some friends home that night, and I made a mental error. I made a right-hand turn from a left-hand lane, and there was another car coming over the hill. And that car smashed into my dad's convertible that I was driving. I was scared. I thought, what is my dad going to say when I have to call home and tell him that I got in an accident? When I got home and I told him what happened, my dad said, "Are you all right?" He said, "Cars can be replaced, but a son can't. I'm glad that you're safe." My father taught me that people are more important than things. He showed me his love that night. My driver's license and car keys reminds me that Dad loved me more than stuff. And the last thing I brought with me is a suitcase because it reminds me of a story that took place when I was in college. It was my first year, and I had to take a bus home from West Virginia Wesleyan, going home to Baltimore. It was snowing really hard, and my driver that was going to take me home said, "I'm not comfortable driving in this snow." So we took the bus. And when I got home to Baltimore, the Greyhound Company had lost my suitcase. It had all my clothes and all my Christmas presents for my family. Well, Dad called the insurance company and he got a check and it paid to replace the clothes. And I got to buy some new presents. I never thought I'd see my suitcase again. Came home for spring break and I get a phone call from the Greyhound Company and they found my suitcase. I got all my, oh my gosh, smelly clothes from first semester, like 5 months later, returned to me. But I got the clothes back, and I got the presents back, and we had Christmas in June, or May, whenever it was. And you know what my dad did? He wrote a check to the insurance company, paying them back for the money that they gave him for the lost items. He said when they came home, they weren't lost anymore, and it would be dishonest to keep that money. And that day, my dad told me, it's important to be honest. And Dad gave me the gift of values, the value of honesty, the gift of his time, the gift of his love, and the gift of values. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for our dads.
Thank you for our dads
who show us your love, and your grace. Amen.
Amen.
Thanks for coming up. Have a good day.
Thank you.
second lesson is also from the Gospel of Matthew. I'm reading in chapter 10, verses 29 through 31. Hear the word of the Lord. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? And yet not one of them will fall to the ground apart from the will of your Father. And even the very hairs of your head are all numbered. So don't be afraid. You are worth more. You are worth more than many sparrows. This is the word of life. Thanks be to God. Amen. May we pray. Lord God, as I prepare to speak, I pray that you will prepare the hearts of those who will listen, that somewhere in the midst of the words I share, your voice will speak to them. Through Christ our Savior, we pray. Amen. Today we salute our fathers. Dads, we love you. Whether living or deceased, we honor and we acknowledge these important men in our lives. The role of a Christian father is more important in today's world than ever before. It's a different role. Fathers play a different role today than they did in earlier generations. In most households today, dad is called upon to play more of a nurturing role in caring for children. If mom works outside of the home, then dad takes a more active role in doing household chores. Dad is no longer lord of the castle, but is an important partner in his marriage and also in the raising of the children. So, today's father needs to be nurturing of his children, supportive of his wife, and yet at the same time provide the spiritual leadership of the home that the Bible accords to fathers. It is a rare man. It is a special man who can combine all three of these qualities. According to Dr. T. Barry Brazelton, a father's involvement with the children of his family increases that child's IQ. The father's involvement with the children of his family increases the child's motivation to learn. And a father's involvement with the children in the home increases a child's self-confidence. In addition, children who have involved dads are more likely to develop a sense of humor, as well as an inner excitement for life. In other words, dads do make a difference. And so we salute our fathers today. Dads, your families need you more today than ever before. The most common image that Jesus used in describing God is that of Father. It makes me think that Joseph must have been a very special kind of father. We center much of our attention on Mary, his mother, but Joseph must have combined those very special qualities of strength and gentleness that we have come to associate with Jesus. Jesus had a very keen knowledge of the Old Testament scriptures. In the Jewish home, it was the father who had the primary responsibility for his son's religious instruction. Now, of course, we know that Jesus had a very special relationship with God, but still, I have to believe that Joseph was probably a very influential role model for Jesus. Why else would Jesus have chosen the image of father to portray God? Our beloved Lord's Prayer begins, "Our Father." So let's just take a few moments and look at those first two words of this great prayer. It begins, "Our Father." The word our means that it is a corporate prayer and not a private prayer. We don't pray my Father, but rather we pray our Father. When we pray, we realize that we are a part of the family of God. That's a worldwide family that includes everyone. God made us all. God loves us all. Our Father is the Father of this church, but also the Father of all churches. God is Father of this great nation of ours, but God is also the Father of all the nations of the world. Our Father is God of both the good and the bad, the rich and the poor, the well-to-do and the down and out. Our Father is God of all the races, which means that we're all kin. We're all brothers and sisters. Our Father reminds us that we belong to one another and we have a responsibility to one another. Am I my brother's keeper? The answer is yes, because God wants it that way. The word our does not imply that we own God and we get to tell God what to do. It means that God is Father of all the people of the world. And that's a concept that is so simple and yet is hard for many to grasp. In addressing God as Father, Jesus makes it clear that meaningful prayer involves a trusting and a loving intimacy. I love the intimacy that's there in the words, our Father. The phrase, Almighty God, and you sometimes hear the pastor use that in a prayer. Almighty God, that conveys the power and the majesty of our God. But our Father declares that God cares for us like a loving parent. There is a closeness that is implied. Even though God is the creator of the universe, God wants to be known in intimate ways. God wants fellowship with the children of the world, with you and me. God wants to relate to us on a personal basis, as a parent to a child. God wants to hear from you every day. God wants you to tell him what's on your heart, the secrets that you don't tell anyone else. What are your fears? What are your desires? What are your dreams? What mistakes are you too embarrassed to tell anyone else? You can tell God. Climb up onto Papa's lap and have a little chat. Now, for some of us, fathers were not the easiest person in the world to talk to. Dad, too often, was busy, or it seemed as though he didn't understand. Or maybe Dad, in your family, or in many families, was the disciplinarian of the family, and children were a bit afraid of Dad. You certainly weren't going to tell Dad your mistakes if you thought you were going to get a lecture. Or if telling your mistakes would get you into trouble. Some fathers, sadly, even abused their children. Some fathers abandon the family. Dad simply isn't there, unavailable. Sometimes there's drugs or alcohol. So for some people, they find it hard to pray, Our Father. I used to be of the mindset that it was wrong to ask people to use the term father because it was a stumbling block for other people. And then I read an article by a woman professor by the name of Roberta Bondi. Professor Roberta teaches church history at the Candler School of Theology in Atlanta, Georgia. The professor recalled how difficult it was for her to use the term father in relationship to God, since her own father was an authoritarian. He was a bit of a perfectionist. and he abandoned the family when she was just 11. She writes that she substituted the word mother or friend in place of God, the Father, for many years. And she encouraged others to do the same. But then she had an epiphany. She had an awakening. She recalled how Philip asked Jesus if he could see the Father. And Jesus replied to Philip's question, "Can I see the Father?" He says to Philip, "When you've seen me, you've seen the Father." Professor Bondi writes, "Jesus was nothing like my Father, my earthly Father. So once I stopped confusing my Father with God, well, then I was able to forgive my Father for his failures towards me and let my Father simply be who he was, a man, not God, but simply an ordinary human being with ordinary human weaknesses." Well, my opinion changed right there. We don't have to stop or force people to stop using the phrase Father for God. If people want to call God Mother for a time, if that helps them in their understanding of who God is, that's fine too. But we need to be reminded that God is the role model for earthly fathers and not the other way around. We don't determine who God in heaven is by looking at our earthly fathers. Perhaps if we see that only God is perfect and only God is a perfect father, then we can stop expecting our earthly fathers to be perfect. And then we can once again call God our Father in heaven, knowing that it's God's love that informs who and what our earthly fathers should be. Who is God? God is love. In Matthew 10, verses 29 to 31, we have one of the most important scriptural reminders of the love of our Heavenly Father for his children. Jesus asks, "Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? And yet not one of them falls to the ground without your Father's will. But even the hairs on your head are numbered. So fear not. You are of more value than many sparrows." What a moving testimony to the very intimate love that God has for each of us. If God knows how many hairs are on my head, God also knows my fears, my anxieties, the guilt and the shame that I carry. God knows the problems that I'm experiencing. God knows about coronavirus. God also knows about racism. And in God's love, God has given us resources to deal with both of those. My point is that God cares about what happens to his children, as does a loving father. Perhaps the most famous verse of the Bible reminds us of that. I'm sure you can repeat it with me. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son." That verse tells us that Jesus did not come into the world to condemn the world. There are some that would lift up the image of God as a divine ruler and a judge who sits on a throne judging the people of the world. But I think a better image of God is that of a loving father who can't wait until all of his wandering children come home. God doesn't want to smash his people into submission. God loves his people. God tries to woo them back to his heart out of love. In Matthew 7, verses 9 to 11 that I read earlier, we are reminded that God desires to give us good things A good father wouldn't give a child who asked for bread a stone, nor would a good father give a child a snake or a scorpion who asked for a fish. God wants to give us good things. God wants to bless us, and God wants to bless us abundantly. And so do good fathers. I have a story I'd like to share with you. There once was an old man who had a young son. They lived in America, but in the man's later years, he had a desire to return to the old country. So he saved all the money that he could, and he bought a ticket for himself and for his youngest son to accompany him as they sailed across the Atlantic Ocean. Having spent all of his money on the tickets, the old man stored away some apples, cheese, and dried meat in his knapsack so they would have food for the journey. They had been on the ship for several days, and in fact, they were nearing the end of their voyage. For all these days, the father and son had stayed in their small room, eating their humble bread. But near the end of the trip, the boy decided to venture out. After an hour or so, he returned. His arms were loaded with food. His father got angry with him, thinking that he had stolen the food from someone else. "Oh, no, Papa," the boy replied. "Didn't you know? All this food is free. It came with the price of the ticket. There are tables and tables of food just waiting for us to eat," the boy told his father. How many of us miss out on the banquet of God's love? Because we think God can't love us that much. A lot of people believe they don't deserve God's love. If God knew what I was like on the inside, God couldn't love me the way I am. Well, maybe God could love me a little, but not a lot. Oh, my friends, God loves us abundantly, regardless of what we've done, regardless of the past, regardless of what we're like on the inside. God doesn't want us eating crumbs, but rather God wants us to feast. Out of God's vast treasure, God wants to give his love for each one of us. At the core of who God is love, and that's what we celebrate this Father's Day. When we recognize that in some small way, our earthly fathers are modeling what the love of our Heavenly Father looks like. Let us give thanks to God for all of our fathers who reflected God's grace, and let us praise God for his immeasurable, for God's immeasurable love. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Before we pray, there are a number of prayer requests that you have shared with me this week. Alice Volentine asked for prayers for her brother Nelson. He is still in ICU. However, they have removed life support, and it is simply a matter of waiting. For Nelson, his family, for Alice and her loved ones, Lord, hear our prayers. Ruth Rollins is in the hospital. She is awaiting hip surgery, but is currently fighting an infection. So until the antibiotics do their job, she is simply in a holding pattern. But prayers for Ruth. Lord, hear our prayers. There was a prayer request for a Fairview High School student. His name is Andrew Dworek. He is diagnosed a few months ago with a rare form of cancer. His mother, father, and sister are also being lifted up in prayer. For Andrew and his family, Lord, hear our prayers. Shannon Gilchrist asked for prayers for her dad. He is battling something that resembles, not definitely diagnosed, ALS or Lou Gehrig's disease. So because of that uncertainty, there is a lot of anxiety. But prayers for her dad and family. Lord, hear our prayer. Shannon also asked for prayer for her grandma. She's having a difficult time adjusting to being a widow. Lord, hear our prayer. We have a prayer request for Robin Neal. Robin is the wife of Pastor Brad Neal. She recently had a very serious back surgery in Pittsburgh and is now recovering. For Robin's recovery, Lord, hear our prayer. A request for Al Williams and family. He's having terrible issues with heart and liver. Lord, hear our prayer. We have a request for Ray and Nancy Bauer upon the death of their son, Michael. Lord, hear our prayer. Chuck Skopow has been in the hospital. He has some very serious health issues. We want to keep Chuck in our prayers as the doctors continue running tests, and prayers for his wife, Gail. Lord, hear our prayers. Fred and Jackie Garnon have a joy that they'd like to share. Their twin grandsons, born premature, just turned 8 years old this week. The boys have finished first grade, and Jackie reports that Bennett, who had the eating disorder, now eats everything. So it sounds like they've come a long ways, and we give God thanks for their recovery and healing. Lord, hear our prayers. We have a request for Carson. She is suffering in unspeakable pain during cancer treatment. She's waiting the results of the last round of treatments. For Carson, her cancer treatments and dealing with pain. Lord, hear our prayers. We have a number of birthdays coming up this week. Let us now take a moment to sing happy birthday to all of our friends celebrating birthdays this week. For your silent requests, may we be in prayer. May we pray. O gracious God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity to gather today to worship and praise you. Thank you for all of the many blessings of life. May we not take them for granted. Thank you for family and friends. Thank you for food and shelter. Thank you for this great land of ours and the freedoms we enjoy. Thank you, Lord, for the beauty of this time of year and the beauty of your creation of all things great and small. Oh God, give us eyes to see your handiwork all around us. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for your love. Amen. Oh God, our Creator, we give you thanks for those who have been fathers to us here on earth. Help us inherit from them that which will make us more fully your people. Where they have offered us blessings of love, may we incorporate those gifts into our lives. Where they have hurt us or fallen short of our expectations, enable us to forgive our fathers for being less than perfect. O God, may the honor we convey upon our fathers reflect the honor that we give to you. Amen. Merciful God, we pray for all the needs of a broken and hurting world. May the sick be comforted and healed. May the hungry be fed and the homeless given shelter. May the downtrodden be lifted up and those who despair find reasons to hope. May those who struggle in any way find helpers to share their burden. Show us, Lord, what part we may play in answering another's prayer. Amen. O Spirit of God, we have heard your call to share in building up the kingdom of God. Fill us with the desire to change ourselves and to change the world. Inflame our passion for justice into a commitment to address unjust situations and structures. Deepen our concern for our sisters and brothers in America and overseas who endure the burdens of poverty, war, exploitation, and persecution. Amen. O God, give us your Spirit that we might enthusiastically play our part in the mission of the church in the modern world. Banish any complacency in our hearts or our minds. Teach us to recognize the lack of justice. May we envision, pray about, and create a different sort of world in which injustice is replaced with a renewed sense of solidarity and care. Enlivened by the Spirit, may we go forth in the peace of the Holy Spirit to love and serve the Lord. In Jesus' name, we pray all these things, and as he taught us, may we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, we acknowledge the gifts that have been received and the gifts that will be received in the coming week to further the ministry of God's kingdom through this local church. Will you join with me as we sing the doxology? May we pray. O God, our Heavenly Father, we are the sons and daughters among whom you have divided your wealth. You have asked only that we use these resources wisely and responsibly. Help us think long and hard what this means and consider faithfully where your church fits in with the exercise of the stewardship of what we have received. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Before giving the benediction, I do want to share some good news with you. The trustees and the team that has been involved in helping to shape policy regarding when we reopen the church met last night. And they've made a decision that we want to carefully but purposely move forward in reopening Lakewood. And to that extent, we're planning a worship service in the park on July 5th. That's Independence Day weekend, and we hope that you will join us. The service will be at 9:30, just one service. We will continue to record the service and then broadcast it through YouTube so that those who aren't comfortable can watch it from home, because not everyone will feel comfortable coming out. And then if the county has gone green, we would like to return to the sanctuary on July 12th. There will be a number of guidelines, and you will receive a letter from the church outlining all the things that are expected and the new changes. But first we have to go green. So once that happens, we are making plans so that we can reopen the church looking at the date of July 12th. So please pray about whether you might return. I know that not everyone will be comfortable, but for those who do, it will be good to see your faces again. Happy Father's Day to all of our dads. Receive now the benediction. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit abide in your hearts and your homes this day and forevermore. Amen.